So it's a great honor to be invited by the European Rhinologic Society to talk about the assessment of the physiology and the function of the nose. So the function of the nose is air climatization, which includes heating and humidification of the inspired air, olfaction, the most vital one is respiration, defense of the respiratory tract, speech, nose is involved in the production of many vowels and consonants. Typical examples are the so-called nasal consonants, N and M. Hemoperception through Jacobson's organ. Facial expression, since nose is covered by many mimic muscles, and almost in all civilizations, a beautiful nose is connected to an attractive face. In order to assess olfaction as a principle, the patients are asked to recognize some odorants that are embedded in sniffing sticks or sniffing scratches. In terms of respiration, 50 to 60% of the total resistance of the respiratory tract is found in the nose. When we have our mouth closed, when we open our mouth, this resistance drops to about 20%. The maximum airflow is over the inferior turbinate, continues to the middle meatus, and exits the nose through the coana. The maximum resistance, as we all know, is at the area of the internal nasal valve, but it is also useful to know the presence of the nasal cycle. This is a periodical change in the resistance between the two nostrils that takes place every 3 to 5 hours, and it is present in about 80% of humans. The lateral wall of the internal nasal valve is flaccid, and the forces that act on it is the negative intravalvular pressure due to Venturi effect, and towards the opposite direction is the rigidity of the upper lateral cartilage and its connection with the lower lateral cartilage, the overlying skin, connective and soft tissue, and of course the nasal muscles. In a position paper that was published in 2018, nasal obstruction was defined as the subjective perception of discomfort or difficulty in the passage of air through the nostrils that may affect up to 40% of the population. It can be unilateral or bilateral, intermittent or persistent, and can be caused by a number of factors. In order to assess nasal obstruction, we can use either objective or subjective assessment tools. Let's see now what happens in everyday practice, and I would like to mention a study that was published in 2017 in the United Kingdom and involved 78 rhinologists of the United Kingdom. So according to the study, almost all of them used clinical history and physical examination in order to assess the airway of their patients. 73% of them used the nasal misting pattern, so under the nose of their patients they put a metallic surface or a glass. And according to the fogging that the airflow through the nostrils was causing to do this surface, they were drawing their conclusions, of course, with relative safety. 29% of them used a questionnaire that is called SNOT, sinonasal outcome test, and only 19% of them used a device that is called peak nasal inspiratory flow meter. Please keep this in mind because we're going to use it later on during this presentation. So 77% of the rhinologists did not utilize objective methods in the clinic, and the reason they give for that is that the equipment is not available in the clinic. They believe that this method would be too time-consuming, and they think that even if they had one, the results would have poor correlation with the subjective feeling of the patients about their nasal patency. Here is the questionnaire's note. The truth is that these questionnaires were first created in order to assess the problems of patients that were suffering from chronic rhinosinusitis. Later on, they were validated, and nowadays they are used in order to assess nasal blockage of every kind. An even more simple and specific subjective instrument is the nasal obstruction symptom evaluation instrument. This consists of 5 questions, so the patients are asked to grade the severity of 5 different problems, 5 different symptoms. We get a score that is multiplied by 5, and then we get a final score with maximum 100. An even more simple instrument is the nasal patency visual analog scale. This is a straight line without calibration. The edge on the left refers to the absence of symptoms. The edge on the right refers to the most severe symptoms. The patient is asked to put a mark on the line, and according to where this mark is put, we draw our conclusions in terms of the severity of their problems. Let's see now the objective assessment tools, and maybe the most popular one is rhinomanometry. You see the setup of the device with a big mask and the connection to the PC. This method calculates airflow in the nasal cavity and also the pressure that is required in order to achieve this airflow. And we get a curve that represents nasal resistance within the nasal airway. In 2010, four-phase rhinomanometry was established, which calculates the nasal resistance in the four phases of nasal respiration. According to recent studies, this method has similar results with classic rhinomanometry. Another very popular method is acoustic rhinometry. With this method, from the edge of the probe that you see is produced an acoustic wave that enters the nasal cavity, reflects, comes back, and we have this curve that represents volume in relation to distance from the edge of the probe. There are two very typical notches in this curve. The first is found at the area of the internal orifice, and the second at the site of the head of the inferior turbinate and the internal nasal valve, and it is the site of minimum cross-sectional area. And let's see now another device that is not that impressive as the previous ones. This is called peak nasal inspiratory flow meter that we talked about before. So although it's not that impressive, it has some very, very important advantages. So it is very easy to use. It is cheap, about £35 in the United Kingdom. It is portable, its measurements are quick, and they have good repeatability. And according to recent studies, they have good correlation with rhinomanometry and acoustic rhinometry. Here is a demonstration of how to use the device. We use the residual volume techniques, which means that we ask our patients first to exhale as much as they can through their mouth, and then after putting the mask on the face, with the mouth closed, they have to inspire as vigorously as they can through their nose. So here's the demonstration, full expiration through the mouth, mask on the face, and full inspiration through the nose with the mouth closed. We usually do three measurements, and we take as valid the one that achieves the best score. So here are the three instruments that I would suggest we should all use in our everyday practice. And the reason for that is that they're very cheap, very easy to use, quick, and they give reliable results. And with these three methods, we did a study in the ENT department of the Academic Medical Center in Amsterdam. And the aim of the study was to investigate the clinical value of peak nasal inspiratory flow in relation to the patient's real experience about nasal patency, which was reflected in their scores on the questionnaire nose and the visual analog scale. Also, as we all can understand, the quality of our breathing through the nose strongly depends on the quality of our lungs, of our lower respiratory tract. And we wanted to investigate if when we assess nasal patency, we need at the same time to assess the condition of the lower respiratory tract. For this reason, we calculated peak oral inspiratory flow. So from the device that I showed you before, we took off the mask and we asked our patients to inspire vigorously through their mouth this time. And with this, we calculated the nasal patency index, which is the score of peak nasal inspiratory flow divided by the score of peak oral inspiratory flow. Some demographics. So here are the final results of the study. I wouldn't like to concentrate too much to numbers, just to give you a rough idea. So according to our study, peak nasal inspiratory flow showed very good correlation with peak oral inspiratory flow and the nasal patency index. Also, peak nasal inspiratory flow showed very strong correlation with the questionnaire nose and the visual analog scale, which means with a subjective feeling of the patients about their nasal patency. On the other hand, peak oral inspiratory flow didn't show good correlation with these parameters. Moreover, the nasal patency index showed good correlation with the questionnaire nose and the visual analog scale. Nevertheless, as you can notice, this correlation was not as strong as the one that showed peak nasal inspiratory flow. And the final result was that the questionnaire nose and the visual analog scale showed very, very strong correlation. So our conclusions were that the nasal airflow is highly dependent on pulmonary function as expected. Peak nasal inspiratory flow shows significant correlation with the nose questionnaire and the visual analog scale, so with a subjective feeling of the patients about their nasal patency. On the other hand, peak oral inspiratory flow does not show good correlation with a subjective individual assessment of nasal patency. For this reason, there is no clinical need to measure peak oral inspiratory flow or to calculate the nasal patency index in the evaluation of nasal patency. Actually, these two parameters are included in the measurement of peak nasal inspiratory flow itself. So peak nasal inspiratory flow measurement is enough. And an additional conclusion was that the questionnaire nose and the visual analog scale are equally useful in assessing the subjective feeling of nasal patency. Since I suggest these instruments, I would like to give you the normal rates in the literature. So for the questionnaire nose, it's 15 with standard deviation 17. For the visual analog scale, it's 2.1 with standard deviation 1.6. Here's a table with the normal scores of peak nasal inspiratory flow in different studies. The high variety of the results was attributed to the high variety of the populations that participated in the studies. These are also some very useful tables. So the four on the left refer to women, to men. The four on the right refer to women. So, for example, if you want to find the normal, the expected normal score of a man at the age of 40 with a height of 180 centimeters, then you go to the table and you see that this should be at around 170 liters per minute. In the same way, if you want to see the normal expected score of a woman at the age of 20 with a height of 160 centimeters, then you go to the table and you find that this should be at around 150 liters per minute. And these three instruments are used a lot in order to assess our post-operative results. And here are some examples from the literature where these three instruments are used in order to assess post-operative results. And I would like to give you two quick examples from my practice to show you the use of these instruments in my everyday practice. So this lady came to the clinic asking for aesthetic and functional improvement of her nose, a severely deviated septum with a crooked nose, and all the measurements showed objectively and subjectively the significant impairment of nasal breathing. So we did an open approach, septoplasty, dehumping and nasal osteotomies, bilateral spreader grafts, cephalic trim, dome creation sutures, spanning suture and tonguing groove. And here is the postoperative result after 2.5 months. And significant improvement of all parameters, objective and subjective. And here is the profile view and the three-quarters view. Also, this lady with a severely deviated septum due to nasal trauma during childhood, all parameters indicative of severe objective and subjective nasal impairment of nasal breathing. So open approach, total septal reconstruction, dehumping and nasal osteotomies, bilateral spreader graft, cephalic trim, dome creation sutures, tip-on-lay graft and diced cartilage on the dorsum at the end of the surgery, tonguing groove and alar rim grafts. And here's the post-operative results after 2.5 months. And all parameters indicative of the significant improvement of nasal breathing, objectively as well as subjectively. So the basal view, we cannot always achieve a complete straightening of the septum and the columella, but the important thing is to give an aesthetic improvement as well as a significant airway. The profile view and the three-quarters view. And in conclusion, I suggest that we should quantify our findings and our results. This will give us a more reliable follow-up. Also, a better communication with our patients. We can show them in numbers what the impact of our interventions is. Also, we can have a better communication between us. And finally, there is potential for research, which will be for the benefit of ourselves and, most importantly, for the benefit of our patients. Thank you.